time is longer, even though it's shorter. I don't know. Some may add up, Jesus. I don't know. Y'all need to go back to school. You know that? She like, I want to. Hey, man. But it's been a blessing. I truly believe maybe it's because it's been raining a lot. It's July, so I don't know what's going on with the planet. Maybe God is just crying a lot more. I don't know. But it ain't my job to figure it out. Mission, vision, to show Jesus to the lost and broken. That's who we are. We want our mission to be to show Jesus to the lost and broken. And we do believe that when that happens, that this is a place where broken people can be healed. We do believe that Jesus is a healer of brokenness. The lost are found. We believe that the lost are found in Jesus Christ. And we want to be a place where people come here and they meet Jesus. They don't just meet Sasha or Al or Deshonda. They don't, you know, they meet Jesus in this place, in this space. They don't just meet Ron, which we got to get Ron here more in order for them to meet him anyways. No, I like messing with you, man. But seriously, they actually meet Jesus Christ. Yes, they meet a group of people who follow and believe in Jesus. So that helps them to meet Jesus Christ. So they meet you, but because they met you, they meet him. Amen. And the people are served. Jesus was a servant. If we do not serve, then what are we doing? Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Let's get to the word. Let's give God some glory in this space today. Lord, we thank you. We love you. We worship you. We honor you. We adore you. You are our King. You are our rock. You are our God. You are everything that we shall ever need. In those times of loneliness or despair, when we feel like we need more, let us focus on you. In those times in loneliness and despair, when we feel like you aren't enough, let us know and have the peace and the comfort that you are enough, Jesus, that you are enough. And in those times of loneliness and despair, when we feel like you're not enough and we feel like we're all alone, Lord, I do pray that you place people around us who know you, who follow you, who love you, who can also be there to strengthen us as well. Because there is a strength in the multitude of counselors. And I pray that the counselors that they are, that they're holy people, they're godly people. I pray that the counselors are people who will lead you unto Jesus Christ, lead them unto Jesus Christ. That the counselors are people who will speak positivity and joy. Oh my God, I don't want to be by myself in this. But the counselors are great and mighty counselors of God. And I pray that if there are some more, oh my God, whoever is a mighty counselor of God in this room, that is tired and weary and that is worn out, I pray that you place mighty counselors of God around them to lift them up and bring them joy. Because even the mighty counselors need some counseling. Even the mighty counselors need some help. Even the mighty counselors need some lifting up from you, from their brothers, from their sisters, from your word, Jesus. And I pray that you lift somebody up today and you give them what they need to carry them through, Lord. Hallelujah and glory. This morning has been gloomy. It's been gloom and doom. But Jesus, we celebrate. Celebrate you today, Lord. And there is no gloom and doom. There is the light of the Lord. There is Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, our rock and our salvation. Hallelujah. The firm foundation upon which we stand. Hallelujah, Jesus. And no matter what spirit of despair wants to be in this place, we rebuke it in the name of Jesus. And the joy of the Lord is here. The love of the Lord is here. The presence of the Almighty God is in this place today. Hallelujah and glory. If somebody is in that feeling, in that way, in that mood, oh, lift them up and lighten their load, Jesus. We thank you. We love you. Bless the children. Hallelujah. Bless everyone throughout the rest of their summer and their times, and let everyone enjoy each other in their household. Oh, let people enjoy their family and their friends. Let people enjoy even their jobs, their businesses, their companies. But let people enjoy the life that you have given them, oh Lord. Oh, we thank you for your word, your mighty and powerful word. Let it come forth today. Speak through the speaker and teach through the teacher and preach through the preacher, Lord. Something that edifies you and glorifies your name, brings us closer to you, and brings somebody that's online or in person to the salvation of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 So y'all know where we at. We on misplaced love. All right? Misplaced love. And this morning, we're going to be on part four. Uno, dos, tres, cuatro. Part four. This part we're going to talk about is the love of words over God's word. Now, I know we had a little bit of conversation last week about talking about the deceitfulness of the prosperity gospel. But we'll get there. I promise you we will. But that's with this. I was looking at both of these this week and I was going into prayer about it. And I feel like God led me in this direction to start here first, because a lot of the prosperity gospel is bleeding false words and false teachings and preachings of the Bible to lead people to something that's not biblical, but it's using what's in this book to be able to get people to have personal gain. I don't want to start no church feuds and I don't want to start no church fights, but that's what I believe on and that's what I stand on. I truly believe that God's word is the ultimate thing that we need. I truly believe that God's word gives us peace. It gives us healing. I truly believe that God's word teaches us just how to live life. Amen. And I probably shouldn't say this, but I will. I believe a non-Christian can read God's word and still live a good life. Does that mean you got salvation? No. But does it mean you can live a good life? Yes. Because what the Bible teaches are things that we can just apply to life through reading and learning and knowing the word that will just do some mighty works on the planet. But at the end of the day, I also have to tell you about salvation. You can know this word better than anything else in the world. Thank you, sir. You can know this word better than anything else in the world. But if you know this word better than anything else in the world, but you do not accept Jesus Christ, you are smart, you are intelligent, you know God's word and you know what he says, but you do not have salvation. So when we talk about this word today, I want to talk about knowing God's word, understanding what it does, and understanding the importance of knowing it and salvation going with it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
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 Amen. The text that we're going to use today, if you don't mind standing for the reading of the word, if you are able to stand. The text we are going to use today, which some of you maybe haven't studied this a lot. Typically, you wouldn't study this a lot if you weren't going to be like a pastor or a minister or something like that, because this is typically the passages in the Bible where Paul is giving instruction unto Timothy. So these passages in the Bible where Paul is giving instruction unto Timothy is basically Paul writing him a letter saying that I have mentored you and helped you grow and watched you in the faith. And now, good son Timothy, these are the things you need to do as you move forward in the gospel. So typically these things get preached in church, but not a lot. And it's not a knock on anything. It's because there are certain letters that were written for certain purposes. This letter's purpose was for Paul to edify Timothy and to grow him and teach him and also to give him confidence in who he was and who Paul had been mentoring him to be. Amen?
Amen.
So Paul is sending this letter to Timothy, and I don't want us to take it out of context, because I'll be honest with you, this letter to Timothy was for Timothy. That's why it's named Timothy. So I'm not trying to throw no shade at you, but this was for Timothy. But in writing this letter for Timothy, Paul is giving us things that we need to follow and listen to and learn and adhere to as we move forward in the gospel ourselves.
Right.
Paul was mentoring Timothy, and now Paul is mentoring us as well through this same letter. Amen?
Amen.
But I don't want to focus on everything in here, but I do want to focus on a couple pieces that I want us to really see and pay attention to. Amen? So we'll read 2 Timothy chapter 2 verses, or chapter 4 verses 1 through 2. 2 Timothy chapter 4 verses 1 through 5. This is 1 through 2, but the verses are 1 through 5. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
Come on, give God an amen, not an amen. Amen. That's what I'm talking about. Amen. I get excited about the word of God. Maybe
that's
you
right.
Don't, but I get excited
save
about
our soul.
Amen. I solemnly urge you in the presence of God in Christ Jesus, who will someday judge the living and the dead when he comes to set up his kingdom. preach the word of God. Preach the word of God. Be prepared, whether the time is favorable or not. Patiently correct. Ooh, Lord, we need a lot of help right there. Patiently correct. Not ignorantly correct. Not even immediately correct. Patiently correct. Rebuke and encourage your people with, somebody say with me, good teaching. For a time is coming when people, go back, one slide, go back. I just want good teaching. Good teaching are the last two words. Next slide. For a time is coming. Good teaching is what we need for when this time comes. Because without good teaching, you can have all the preaching in the world. Don't get me wrong. I love it shouting. None of that bothers me. I'm not. Shout all you want, but shout with some good teaching.
Right.
Don't just shout with some emotion. Shout with some good teaching. Amen. Because if I'm shouting, but it ain't no good teaching, there's a time that is coming. And if it ain't no good teaching, then I'm doing unnecessary shouting. But when you see me shouting, it's because I'm understanding the teaching and what's happening in the body of Christ from the word. Amen?
Amen.
So for a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. I love the terminology of doctrine. Just that's me. I love when he says to a sound doctrine. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. So they will look for people who will tell them what they want to hear, but not for people who will give them the truth. I'm about to get into it. Let me read the rest of the text. They will reject the truth and chase after myths. Don't go next. Go back. Why will they reject the truth and chase after myths? Because their itching ears only want to hear what they want to hear and not what the word of God tells us. Amen. So when my itching ears want to hear what I want to hear and not what the word tells me, I will naturally reject the truth because, oh my God, because the truth is not what I sometimes want to hear. Next slide. But you should keep a clear mind in every situation. Don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Work at telling others the good news and fully carry out the ministry God has given you. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. Amen. The first thing I want to talk about here, I have 3 points and then I'll be out of your way. Amen. And if y'all ain't noticed, we started at 11:06 today. There will be no more starting at 11:20, 11:30. We starting at 11 a.m. Can I get an amen? Can I get an amen? I love you. But if you walk up in here at 11:45 and I'm already preaching, we love you. But just do me a favor. Don't walk in front of Trey camera. Amen. You still welcome to come, but just go around the backside, all right?
Oh, no.
But the first piece I want to talk about is fables over truth. And I want to, can you go to verse 3, please? And I want to have a discussion a little bit about Paul making it very clear that people will no longer listen to sound doctrine and they will just listen to whatever their ears want to hear. And I want to talk a little bit about how we will start to believe fables over truth. And the reason why we will start to believe fables over truth is because if you remember last week, we had a conversation about the era of selfishness and how we're in an era where everything has to be about me and we should love ourselves. But if I only love myself and never want God to show me how to love other people, then I'm living in an era of selfishness because it's about me. So now as we continue to move forward, we were in 2 Timothy chapter 3 last week. Now let us continue to move forward and we're in chapter 4. And we can see that as we start to love ourselves, we start to fall into this era of itching ears because loving myself means what? I only want to hear what I want to hear. If I am in this space where I can only love me, and I want to exclude or not be a part of, or I just am simply like, you know what, I gotta do me right now, it's all about me, my ears sometimes can tend to only want to pay attention to the things that people say that best benefit me, that interest me, or what I want to hear. This is why a lonely person, and I ain't gonna single out just a woman, a lonely man or a woman can fall victim to somebody with some slick game, because they just wanna hear something that's gonna make them feel like they gonna be in a relationship, knowing that this person don't mean no good. Knowing you done seen 17, 18, 19, 20 signs in the last 4 weeks that you need to leave, but because you got itching ears, cause you just want to be in a relationship so bad, you ignore the signs and you decide to just stay. Now, I'm not knocking you, but what I am saying is this. We develop itching ears for things when we develop a heart in the era of things being all about me. This is why we have to know how to spread love, love ourselves, give love. Love myself, give love. Love myself, give love. Love myself, give love. And ultimately, love him. So as we talk about truth in fables, Paul is letting us know people will follow their own desires and they'll look for teachers who tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. This is how we start to fall for the fables of doctrine. This is how, as we start to only want to hear the fables that people tell us what we want to hear, we start to fall and not recognize the truth. Amen. But in today's world and sermons and scriptures, you can't just give the truth anymore. And this is what makes the gospel really hard nowadays, because back then you could just give the truth and it would create transformation, because people were looking for something and it was kind of new. And y'all know I ain't lying. When it's new, we be interested. Sometimes don't matter what it is. If it's something new, I'm going to take a peek at it. I'm going to take a little look. And back then the gospel was kind of new and it was doing some great things. So people were interested in what the gospel was doing. So Paul had an understanding, let's be honest, and I probably shouldn't say this, but I will. People who believed in the false gods had itching ears to hear the gospel about Jesus Christ. Right. It's true. People are going to always have itching ears, whether you believe in Jesus or you believe in an Ashtoreth or you believe in somebody else. You're going to have an itching ear to want to hear something that may be beneficial to you. This is why Paul says we must preach the word of God and we must have the sound doctrine. So when the ears start to itch, we can decipher the truth from the fable. And when we talk about today's church, we have to talk about the application. In nowadays church, the truth is not enough. In nowadays church, we have to preach the truth, but we also have to preach the truth with application. What's the number one thing people ask me as a pastor after a sermon? Pastor, I wish we could put the points that you make up on the screen. Pastor, how can I apply what you just preached? I try to do my best every week to give an application for you to be able to apply the truth that you just received. But I understand sometimes it doesn't always get across, and that's okay. I ain't mad at you. Please don't be mad at me. But I understand that we want to be able to apply what we're hearing. Because when we hear the truth, now we need to know how to apply the truth. Because if I don't know how to apply the truth and I just hear the truth, then sometimes I can fall for something that's false. But can I say something? That is one space where I feel like the church needs to come out of, although I don't believe we will. But where we need to come out of is that space. And why? Because the Bible says now faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Hearing the word of God should be enough for me to understand and learn how to apply it. And I know some of y'all are like, no, pastor, like I need some blah, 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 blah. Can I give you something that I probably am going to get in trouble for? But I'll say it anyways. You don't need nobody to tell you how to pray. I pray for you. I pray with you. But can I be dead honest with you? You don't need nobody to tell you how to pray. I can tell you scriptures to pray over a situation in your life, but you know the hell that you're going through, and you know what you need from God. See, if I make you feel like you can't pray without me, you become pray, P-R-E-Y, instead of being able to pray, P-R-A-Y. Because now your need and ability to pray becomes, okay, I'm by myself. It becomes predicated to me having to tell you what to say and do. So now in order for you to pray, you need somebody to tell you what to say and how to do it. But the reality is this. If faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God, I'm hearing the word of God, so therefore my faith should be increasing. And I know that that might be a contradiction to some things, but that's what the Bible says. So then faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. You, the only way to believe in the Bible, believe in Jesus, is to hear the word.
Yep.
That's why you have to show up and you have to get the word. You could sit in this church for 20 years and never accept Jesus, but one day I believe that you will because you keep getting the word. See, the word is what's going to bring the faith, not me standing here with a Jesus loves you shirt on. That's the word, but it's got to be more than that. It's got to be the Bible. It's got to be application. It's got to be realizing that I must love God's word over the words of the world. The sermon is titled The Love of Words Over God's Word, because what we have to begin to start doing is to no longer fall in love with the words of the world with our itching ears and fall in love with the word of God. If I fall in love with the word of God, then I don't chase after myths. Because when a myth or a fable comes, I can point it out, recognize what it is, and I ain't chasing after it. So let me ask you a question. How many of us only get the word on Sunday? How many of us only get the word on the daily through the Bible app? This isn't a judgment. This is me simply asking you, because I want you to fall in love with the word of God. See, can I give you something that is a necessity in our faith in Jesus Christ? It is to fall in love with the word. Can I give you something? Can I give this to you? You love Jesus, right? Okay. I really believe you. I'm not trying to throw no shade or nothing. You love Jesus. What does the Bible say in John chapter 1? I'm going to read it for you so you know I ain't crazy. Come on, somebody. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Come on. All things were made through him. Come on. And without him, nothing that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot comprehend it. The scripture is talking about Jesus.
Absolutely.
If I love Jesus, I have to love this word.
That word, that's right.
I promise you, I'm not trying to throw no judgment. I want to teach you for this first part, because I want you to love the word of God so much that it convicts you when you don't read it. I want you to love the word of God so much that you feel bad if you don't go to your Bible in a situation where you need some help. Now, the church will always be here. Feel free to reach out. But what I'm saying is this. I want you to love the word of God so much that when it's being preached to you and spoken to you, that you stay off of your phone.
Right.
You can do what you want, but I want you to love the word of God so much that when you're getting a word, you take the initiative to take notes. And I know you might be like, oh, this dude, he being too much, he doing too hard. No, no. I'm telling you this because I know what the word can do. I want you to love the word of God so much that it's something that you can't live without. See, and I know that sounds crazy, but if you can love the word of God so much that it's something that you can't live without, the increase that it will do in your life is amazing. But I have to love something to want to be with something. Y'all heard me say this before. Most marriages fail when the love dies, and you have to figure out how to rekindle or continue the love. If there is no love, 9 times out of 10, you're going to eventually get divorced. Most people stop having a relationship if they feel like there's no connection or there's no love or something is missing. But if I love the word of God, that means I feel disconnected when I don't have it. So all I'm saying to you today, I'm just trying to teach you something, is I want you to love the word of God so much that you feel disconnected when it's not being put in you. Yeah. I'm by myself. I want you to love the word of God so much that when you need it, you run to it. Because see, I tell you something, as people, we tend to run to other words over the word of God. I want you to love the word of God so much that when you hear other words, that they don't affect you because you know what the word of God says. I want you to love the word of God so much that when life isn't going the way that you wanted or expected, you still have something to rest in and sit in and believe in and know because you know what the word says. This is just me asking you to love the word of God. That's all this is. This isn't rocket science. This isn't algebra. I can't even do algebra. I be calling other kids to help my kids with their algebra. Because if you ask me, it will not get done. But if you ask me a Bible verse, I'll take you there or I'll give it to you or we'll talk about it. But don't ask me no algebra. I don't love algebra, so I don't need to learn algebra. I don't love science, so I'm not going to learn it. I'm not against it, but I don't love it. So all this is just me saying to you, love the word of God so much that when the fables come, your ears don't start to itch and you fall victim and you start to reject the truth and chase after myths. See, Paul had to give Timothy this description because Paul understood what Timothy's calling was going to be. And it was to preach the word, to give the word, to bring the word. But it's a necessity that God's word becomes paramount over the description or the tactic of the enemy. See, when we're talking about the sermon series of misplaced love, sometimes we place our love in the words of the world over the words of God. And what I mean by that is this. Sometimes we place our belief or faith in something that someone says about us, something that someone says will happen, but it's not a word from God. It's a word from human. And because it was a word from human, we place our faith and belief and our all in it, but it wasn't a word from God. And then when it doesn't happen, we get disgruntled with God. But it was never a word from God in the first place. God's word will always be here. If a prophet speaks to me, but he doesn't speak something that's in the word, I have to question the prophecy. If you've been in church 100 times and you've been told if you give $1,000, you're going to get 10,000 back, and you gave 1,000 twice and you ain't got 10,000 back once, that's not a prophecy, that's a scam. And I'm probably going to get in trouble for saying this, but the truth is the truth. And to apply the truth, you need to, oh my God. Nope, I'm not going there because I got to get somewhere else. If a prophet is continuously giving you a word and it's not coming to pass, where is the word coming from? The only reason I'm preaching to you and I'm teaching to you to love the word of God is because the word of God. Matter of fact, I'm not even going to say it. I'm going to ask you a question. Who in this place has the word of God gotten you through? Am I by myself? Am I the only person where the word of God has gotten me through? Not nobody else. Am I the only person who God's word is what I had to rely on when I had nothing else to rely on? Am I the only person that my love for the word was so strong and it was so deep and I wanted it so bad? Am I the only person that when I needed somewhere to go, something to rely on, I just picked up the word because I had nobody else? Maybe I am by myself. Maybe that means some of us maybe need to start just relying on God's word. Can I be honest with you? And I ain't trying to be mean. Sometimes rely on the word before you pick up the phone. Oh, I'm all by myself now, and that's okay. I'm by myself now, but I don't know. But it's been some things where I couldn't rely on nobody. I couldn't call nobody. I didn't have a mentor. I didn't have anyone. All I could do was just go and rely on the word of God. I didn't have a cell phone. I didn't have a tablet. I didn't have social media. It's been some times and some places and some spaces where all I could do is go and open my Bible and read and let the word tell me what it is. Myself, and I'm okay with that. But the thing about it is this, what that did was instill in me that when the going gets tough and the tough got to get going to the word of God.
That's right.
And the misplaced love that we continuously fall upon is misplacing our love in the words of the world and not the words of God. And I'll prove it to you. How many of you, y'all have heard me say this before. This is probably the greatest example in my opinion. How many of you believe the story of Alexander the Great? Who knows history? Anybody know the Greek king? His father, Philip, was Macedonian. If you've heard the story, they made a movie about it. I believe Colin Farrell played Alexander, I believe. I might be incorrect, but you Google it for me, somebody, and let me know before the sermon is over. But they made a movie about him. And the reason why I say we believe the words of the world over the word of God is because the Bible in the New Testament is the only book that we have from ancient antiquity where we have 23,600 copies. I believe it's 6 different languages, and it's 98% accurate to the King James Version. The Bible is the only book in the New Testament that we have where the words of the New Testament were written by the people that lived it, or I told Tim and Tim went and told and Tim went and wrote it down. Every other book that we have from ancient antiquity was not written down by the person who lived it or written by the person who stood next to the person who was living it. Every other book from ancient antiquity that we have was written down at a minimum of 50 and at some cases 2,000 years after. Why am I saying this? Because when we look at the New Testament of the Bible, what that means is it can't get no more accurate than the New Testament of the Bible. Why is that important? Because we will see the story of Alexander the Great in the history books and we'll learn it, read it, know it, and we will believe it. But we will read the stories in the Bible and we will say, no, that can't be true. We will doubt and question the Bible, and if God is going to work for us, we will doubt and question the Bible if God is going to bless us. We will doubt and question the Bible if God will heal us. But we will believe the words in the history book that are there, but the story was not scribed until 1,500 years after he lived. So what am I saying to you? What I'm saying is this. Sometimes we fall victim to loving the words of the world and believing in them before the word of God without even knowing it. Some of us believe that Rick Ross sold dope, but he stole the name. Some of us believe our favorite rapper is really in the trap house and was raised in the streets, but he never did. He telling you his uncle's stories. He telling you his daddy's stories. He telling you his older brother's stories. He telling you the stories of those around him, but he ain't never shot a gun. He ain't never put a hit. He ain't never done none of that, but we believe it because it's in song form and it's true. But then when I tell you about Jesus, when I tell you about Jesus, oh, Pastor, that's a white man thing. Oh, Pastor, that ain't the only way to God. Oh, Pastor, there's no way that can be true. Oh, Pastor, come on, man, you really believe in that stuff. If you believe dirt, why can't I believe in the Bible? Let me be quiet.
White man religion.
Let me be quiet. Entertainers get more credit and truth for them than the word of God does, because it's set up in a way to make us believe what they say. It's set up in a way to make us believe in what they're giving us so we can become a consumer of it.
Right. All about the
but the word of God is not set up in a way for you to become a consumer from a financial perspective. It's set up in a way for you to become a consumer of the word being on the inside of you and building you up. But we love the words of this world. And some of y'all are like, well, I don't love those songs. Man, stop. You was in your car. I love this song right here. And every... I got to slow down because sometimes I'll be finna say something I shouldn't say. I stopped listening to rap music. I used to. Every song, though, what am I putting in my spirit? Some of us want life transformation, but we don't want to give up some of the things that impart on the inside of us from listening to the words. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, right? That's what the Bible says. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of Jay-Z.
Uh-oh.
See, you ain't paying attention. You think that is just by the word of God. You think Jay-Z was the biggest dope boy in New York because of all the music that he made. You think Biggie Smalls was selling dope in Brooklyn. Maybe he was, I don't know, but you believe it. You think Tupac was gangster. Tupac went to art school.
Yes, he did.
Was never a gangster in his life.
Dear mommy.
But he made gangster rap. And he made us kill each other. He made us hate each other. He started a war between two coasts. And the man never was in the street in his whole life.
Dear mommy.
I'm by myself. You see the power of words. Had people out here banging, throwing up they set. Had people out here busting. You got Bloods and Crips shooting at each other in different cities. All because Tupac and Biggie is beefing. Wait, is Biggie a Crip? How you know that? Let me be quiet. Listen, all I'm saying is, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So then faith comes by Lil Durk, and Lil Durk words become God. So then faith comes by listening to NBA Youngboy, and his words become God. So I'm gonna be honest with you. I think I caught a fair case for listening to Young Jeezy, if you want me to tell you the truth. Cause I got out of county home school, said I wasn't selling dope no more. And I started listening to Jeezy, and in the Thug Motivation 101, and they gave me a Caprice with the 20-inch gold rims on it. And I was rolling clean and said, man, you got out here, take this car. And I said, man, I might have to start selling dope again, man. And I'm listening to Young Jeezy, I'm listening to T.I. and the trap music and all of that. And I wanted to tell myself they wasn't influencing me, but I was burning dro and rolling on 24s, and I was doing all that. And I thought I was cool. If you knew me then, you know I ain't lying. Had the sound system in the trunk and was riding around. Thought I was the man. I wasn't leaning. I ain't like leaning to mess your car up. So I just want to stay. I want to stay straight. But listen to me. I thought I was the man. And until I met Jesus, I could never admit that they influenced me to do some things I shouldn't have been doing. I grew up listening to rap music. I grew up listening to kill, kill, bang, bang, drugs, drugs, who cares about women, pop, pop, pow. I grew up listening to it. And then I said to myself, that didn't influence me because the devil is a lie.
Yep.
Oh, I'm by myself. And the devil made me believe that that's a lie. They're not influencing me. I'm making my own decisions. I'm making my own choices. This ain't got nothing to do with Satan. I'm my own man. I can make my own choices. But the reality was this. I was putting the spirits on the inside of me. And those, oh my God, I'm by myself. We got to admit sometimes that we put spirits on the inside of us that lead us in the wrong direction. Ooh, wait till we get to the pigs in the parlor. Oh my God. And we start talking about some of these spirits. Pray for me. Pray for me because the enemy gonna be on attack.
But
listen to me very closely. I lied to myself because the devil is a liar. And when I'm doing the devil's work, I'll lie to myself. I'll lie to you. I'll lie to you. I'll lie to you. I'll lie to you. I'll lie to you because he's lying to me. But I'm telling myself, ain't nobody lying to me because I am who I am. I do what I do because I'm a man and I make my own choices. I'm a man. Can't nobody tell me not to do nothing. I'm a man. Ain't nobody tell me to do that. Yes, the devil did. The spirit behind the music, the spirit behind the drugs, the spirit behind it was pushing you forward in the wrong direction. I think we read this text and sometimes we interpret the text as Paul is only talking to Christians, but nowhere in here does Paul label it for Christians only. He said there's a time coming when people will no longer listen to sound doctrine. He didn't say they already believed in Jesus. It's some people who won't believe in Jesus because they just won't listen to sound doctrine. And I think a lot of times we've interpreted the text that Christians and Christians and Christians and Christians and Christians and Christians, oh, they don't want to hear sound doctrine no more. Paul is talking about the world. He's talking about everybody in it, from a Christian to a non-Christian, from a saved and sanctified believer to a non-saved and sanctified believer. He's talking and he's saying there's a time when people will no longer listen to the sound doctrine of the Bible. I'm about to talk about y'all favorite superstar. Don't get mad at me. There was a time when Beyonce talked about Jesus. And now we live in a time where she puts her period blood on the scripture, on the Holy Scriptures pages in her video. Go look it up on the Lemonade song. I'm all by myself, and that's okay. You can go spend all the money on a concert. I ain't mad at you. I'm going to be right here on Sunday hugging you and loving you. But go look up the video. She did it, not me. Her period blood coming on the sanctity of the Holy Scriptures. That's her video, not mine.
I'm putting a ring on it, Pastor.
Y'all ain't listening. Itchy ears for money, itchy ears for fame, itchy ears for myself, itchy ears for my glory, itchy ears for my prosperity, itchy ears for my personal gain, itchy ears to be better than you, itchy ears to take you out, itchy ears because I gotta be at the top. Oh my God, I'm all by myself. I'm gonna talk about your favorite rapper's favorite rapper. We love Jay-Z, but Jay-Z made it very clear that he don't think the Bible is real. Now, can I ask you this question? Why do you still listen to a man who told you that the Bible is not real? And I know some of you might be like, Pastor, you're going too hard. You're judging me. I'm trying. I'm not even telling you never to listen to the man again. I'm proposing a question to you. When the Bible says Jesus was amongst sinners, he was amongst them trying to change them and show them the truth. Do you have access to Sean Carter to show him the truth? Can I say something? So the poison that he gives you, you can't give the light back. So listen to how this goes. You fill something up with poison and you can't give the light of the world back. It only can keep getting poison pushed in and nothing pushed back. So the more the poison I take in my body and I bring through my ears, you don't have access to talk to any of them about Jesus. All you doing is filling your mind with the poison and can't even give them the word. And not only not give them the word, you eliminate yourself from getting the word. I know some of y'all think I'm going hard, but.
Thank you for going hard. Thank you. Hard to paint, bro.
We place our love in things that pollute us over the things that wants us to be pure. Watch this. Can you come out of here? I'm gonna do it. Don't you ain't even gotta get up. I'm gonna show y'all something better than I can tell you. Can you hear that? You can't hear that, can you? How you turn the volume up on here? Ain't no volume. Is it on the side? All right.
So you create your own laws, circumvent God's laws, and then you make the power of the Bible of no effect in your life. So for you, it's only church, but not transformation. Man, I used to run with this system, and now, man, she's on fire for God, and I'm still stuck dealing with the same stuff because the Word of God has no power in your life. Because every time the Lord confronts you from the Word, you create a law against His Word. I already know. Your boyfriend is a law against the Word. Your girlfriend is a law against the Word. The sin that you love is a law against the Word. All the things that God is trying to work out of you to transform you, you make laws against His Word. Oh, not your wife, no. You make a law against that. Be submitted to your husband. You make a law against that. Now, I'm not going to be submitted to my husband. I don't trust men like that. Get healed and then be submitted to God's Word. Right. Not your wife as Christ of the church. No, she don't deserve that kind of love. Neither did you when He died on the cross. Well, no, I'll love her that way when she starts doing this for me. When she starts cooking for me, I'll do what she do. No, you're creating a law to circumvent the Word of God. How many times?
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Y'all see that?
Yeah.
We love God's word. We love these other words. I'm going to stay here a few seconds, a few minutes. We create, like he just said, laws to circumvent what the word says. The reason why I talked about rap music is because some of us will leave here today and create an excuse or a law to circumvent the fact that that stuff is bad for your spirit. Some of us will leave here today and create the same thing like what he just said. Well, I'm not doing that for my wife because she don't do this. But the Bible says that to love your wife as Christ loved the church. Jesus died for the church. He washed the feet of his disciples. Like, Jesus is going to come back and get his church. So he is the groom coming for his bride. But some of us will say, until my wife does this, I won't do that. Some of us wives will say, until my husband does this, then I'm not going to do that. See, we're creating this era, when I talk about an era of selfishness, to where if you don't do this, I won't do that. And it's giving us the opportunity and the ability to avoid and circumvent what the Word of God actually says. Because we live in an era where if this doesn't happen, I won't do that. But the reality is this, I have to do what this Word says regardless of whatever else happens.
Right.
I'm all by myself, y'all ain't understanding that. I gotta do what the Word says regardless of whatever else happens in my life. If my life is hell and the rain is coming and I'm in a storm, Jesus, he quieted the winds and the waves. And it's a peace, be still. So even if life is stormy, I still must be still. I'm by myself. Listen to me, family. We've taken on words and loved them. And I'm a firm believer. When I saw this, I knew what it was. The only reason we've taken on words and loved them is because those words have given us the ability to circumvent what God is trying to tell us. Can I be honest with you? One of the hardest things you will ever do is try to follow Jesus. If not the hardest. I heard a big old sigh. But listen, I know.
Yes,
I'm a pastor and I'm telling you, listen, hey, bruh, sometimes I don't want to be pastor. I want to be Jordan. I want to be 2007 Jordan. You know, I want Jordan. But what I'm trying to say to you is this. Sometimes we love these other words because it gives us the ability to circumvent what we know we should be doing. And can we talk for a second? How many of you, when something gets really hard, do you all of a sudden want to give up? How many of you, when your marriage got hard, you just wanted to quit? How many of you, when raising your children got hard, you just wanted to find a babysitter? Or I joked about summer school and all that, but the truth of the matter is, summertime be hard for parents with kids. We got six. And how many of you, when the kids at home and the daycare cancel or something like that, look, she like, oh my God, talk to me.
Lord help. And how
many times you be like, do you start looking for somebody else to come get these kids? How many of you get frustrated because won't nobody come and get the kids, but you want them to come get them? See, all I'm saying is this. We'll look for a way to circumvent what God's word says in raising up our children, in submitting, in loving, and all of these different things because it's hard. See, you're not following everything God has asked you to follow because you're a terrible person.
Right.
You're not doing it because it's just hard. And we naturally are inclined to do what's easy. If you think about David and Bathsheba, it was about her looks and beauty on the roof, but it was also about it being easy. Because if David was a peasant, he would have never been able to get to her. But it was easy. See, we're naturally inclined to go after the easy. So we create ways to circumvent God's word to make our life easier. And then, though, what happens is my life may become easier. But even though it's easier, I don't have the same relationship with him.
Right.
I can make life easy. I'm going to be honest with y'all. I can preach. There's nobody who can stop me. I can shut this church down after this sermon today. Mm-hmm. And I can go ahead and work my job.
What job is that?
You want it? I can go ahead and work my job. Deal with everything over there. Like I'm finna be transparent with y'all. I ain't gonna tell y'all my business, but it's, I got a lot going on in my life. And I can right now say, man, I'll be done with this church. Because I got so much going on in the rest of my life. I'm done with this. But the thing about it is this. If I go after what's easy, how am I pursuing and doing kingdom work? My only knock on some churches is when they make ministry too easy.
Come on.
We look for ways to make ministry easier as opposed to looking for ways to make ministry stronger.
Come on.
We look for ways to make it easier as to opposed to making it more effective.
Come on.
Being effective isn't easy.
Come on.
Am I lying? Being effective isn't easy. Steph Curry probably shoot 1,000 shots a day just to be the best three-point shooter. That ain't easy to get up and do the discipline. Kobe getting up at 4 a.m. working out three times a day. Discipline ain't easy. But we look for things to be easier. Not realizing that sometimes am I by myself, the harder it is, the better the outcome is gonna be. The harder it is on the other side, if I stick with it and I keep going with this gospel, the better the outcome is going to be. It don't have to be 1,000 people in this church, 10,000 when I die. But what if 10,000 people get saved because of the ministry that we have here? But we circumvent God's word looking for the easy way out. The people built the golden calf. Because it was easier to just do that. Stop chasing this God who said they got a promised land for him. My last point, and I'm done. I'm going to play one more video. Al, can you do me a favor? Can you bring me that pitcher? And can you bring me that water, that cup next to the pitcher? I want to show y'all something. I want to show y'all why it's so important to get God's word in you. Can I show y'all? Can I show y'all? I'm gonna put this right here. Put this here. Can everybody see this?
You want somebody to hold it?
No, cause this water is gonna spill. If you can't see it, I encourage you to stand up so you can. Thank you. See, it ain't easy.
Example.
It ain't easy. Yes. Show y'all something.
A little bit of science.
Failed science.
There's no
word.
Do y'all see that? And I want to show you the same thing. If you look at the example, you have a dirty cup, right? I don't know if y'all are catching the correlation of all the sermons coming together from the epigenetics and the self-love last week to the first week about misplaced. I don't know if y'all been really paying attention, but that's why I've been saying don't miss a series because all of them go together in one. If you look, that first cup is dirty. And I love this video because the person, this is a dirty cup. It's full of, what are you full of? What are you full of? Are you full of trauma, abuse, anger, lust, jealousy, gossip. What are you full of, right? What are you full of? Are you full of the rap music? And I promise y'all, I'm not judging you. I just want you to understand, it's your job to make the decision, but it's my job to tell you what it does to your spirit. Whether you want to believe me or not, that's up to you. But it does something to your spirit. And when you look at this, this was the grandparents. See, we want our generational traumas and curses to stop, but I don't think we understand the power in God's word in order for that to happen. So if these are the grandparents, and the grandparents, they cup is, you know, hey man, this is what it is. And can I tell y'all something? In my household, I'm first generation Christian. True story. I'm talking about between me, my mom, and my brother. First generation Christian. Watch this. This is grandparents, still dirty cup. But remember, what's in you gets poured into what comes after you. So if the word isn't in you, what are you gonna pour into those coming after you? What are you gonna pour into those mentoring you? If I'm a pastor, what am I gonna pour into you if I don't know the word?
Right.
It don't make sense.
Right.
You pastor, but you don't even know the word. If I'm a pastor, what am I pouring into you if I recycle the same sermons? Don't get me started. But what am I pouring into you if I just have recycled sermons that we do every single year? We just recycle them all the time, over and over and over. I'm not getting a new word or a refreshed word. I'm getting them bringing the same word. So I'm just recycling things. Eventually, you can only recycle so much before you can't recycle it no more. See, we got to understand. You gotta understand, church, a great word is a great word, but God will continue to give us a great word if we keep searching his word and seeking for understanding and wisdom and knowledge. But the video says these are the grandparents, but the grandparents poured us into the parent. Now, can I say something? Jesus was the Son of God. God sent a pure word to come to get rid of all the negative words that was in us. So the grandparents pour it to the parents. But man, the parents, are they the parents? Now I'm talking to the parents. What should I do next? A word of God. Now I want you to notice something as we pour this. I want you to see it. It gets cleaner and cleaner the more word I add to. Wait a minute. The more word I keep putting in.
Come on, come on.
I think I'm by myself. But the more word I keep putting in, the cleaner the cup starts to become. But what I'm noticing, oh my God, I'm by myself. But what I'm noticing is this. I'm pouring the word in and it didn't get clean right away. But I kept pouring the word, and I keep 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 pouring the word. And now, what I end up left with is a clean cup for my children. Somebody better give God some glory if God didn't clean your cup. Because you love the word so much that your cup is clean. Your cup is overflowing with the word of God. I'm by myself and I'll be okay. But I'm telling you right now, if this is your cup and this used to be your cup, I want you to look at what's behind. This is what you left behind. Somebody give God some glory. And it does not have to be a part of your life no more. And all you have is a clean cup of God's word. And that's it. But it started. Remember when I told you in the beginning, I want you to love God's word so much? It started with the love of his word. the cleansing, the purification, the reverse osmosis, whatever you want to call it, it started with the love of the Word of God.
Amen.
Why am I saying this to you today? I love you, but some of y'all think it's funny when y'all pull off out from the church listening to trap music. I love you and I ain't mad at you, but if I can't tell you the truth, watch this. I pull off going back to negative words. See, what I didn't tell you is this. I left some coffee in this cup. I come get a clean word, and I love the word. I get edified by the word, and my cup is clean. But I pull off. See? See?
All the drink. Everything.
It's right back dirty. It's right back dirty. Because I got a word that cleaned me and it purified me. I got baptized and I got saved and purified and God forgave me and everything was washed away. The holy water of baptism is clean. But then when I was done with my baptism, I went right back and I started calling Shorty again. Hey, what's up, baby? How you doing, man? A brother feel good? I got baptized today. Yeah, I feel real good. Feel real good. Now you start stirring up all the bad stuff again. So now, that cup that just was clean, all I, oh my God, already. Already. The cup that just was clean. See, what I'm trying to say to you is this. You got caught for a reason. You got caught for a reason. Because God was trying to clean your cup. See, the world tells you that what's in the dark comes to the light. But if you know the text says that Jesus is the light. The Bible ain't always talking about the light of the CNN cameras. It's talking about what's in the dark comes to the light of Jesus. Because he sees everything. I'm by myself. You better give God some glory. But you got caught for a reason. Because God was trying to clean your cup. Don't you allow him to catch you and show you and expose you to yourself to turn back around and dirty your cup up again.
Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Forgive us, Lord.
See, y'all need the drummer for you to get hype. But when I tell you to love God's word, where's my tambourine at? When I tell you to love God's word, where's my shout at? Where's my clapper at? Where's my person who been clean and they cup ain't filled back up? Who refuse to allow the enemy to fill their cup back up with the sin of the world, with the death, the destruction, the poison? Somebody, oh my God, give God some glory in this place. Can you give me some more water? Can you give me some more water? Give me 5 minutes because I want to show you something. I want to show you something. Oh my God. If you listen to the word, now watch this. Remember, the cup that got empty was you. The cup that got empty was you. Now watch this. Remember, your children was next. Your children was next, right? The children was next. Well, your children get the same cup that you give them. Your children get the same cup that you give them. See, you screaming at your kids and you blaming them for their behavior, but they ain't doing nothing but giving you the same cup that you gave them. And then you wonder why you got a disconnect. You want them to do something that you won't do. So you giving them a hypocritical cup because that's what you always been. You want them to read their Bible and go to church and go to children's church and listen. But you go to church and stand in the hallway and talk during praise and worship. But your kids better be sitting in children's church listening to the teacher. But you should be in here worshiping the master. I'm all alone on that one. I'm all by myself. But listen, listen. Now you done put this in your kids' cup. They didn't do it. You did. Now your kids have kids. And then look what happens. The cup. But this is the thing. The dirtier the cup gets, the dirtier the cup gets. It keeps getting dirty because there is no more word. Watch something. Let's go back into the puddle. We're going to call this the puddle of mess.
The mire.
Can I say something? It's so much mess in this puddle, you can't even stand up. Look at the cup. It's so much mess in this puddle, you can't even stand up. Can you go give me about three more pictures? They in that cabinet in there. Give me about three more pictures. We're going to improvise this thing now. Now you standing in a puddle of mess because God cleaned the puddle. But you went back to trap music. You went back to the house he told you not to go to. You went back to the spirits that he told you to stay away from. You went back to your sage. You went back to your incense and your rocks. You went back to everything that God says is a false idol. You went back to incantations and mantras and chants. You went back to the dope game. You went back that way. So now a lot of us, baptism, you get baptized and yeah, it's going to be a struggle, but you don't have to get dirty again. But you went back. And now look, your whole family can't float. But can I point something out? You notice the only cup that still has some sort of balance is the children. Because there's still hope for them. But can I say something? Because y'all ain't all alone. You put some water in them? Yes, sir. That's a blessing. Thank you. You can't stand. Can't stand. Grandparents can't stand. But eventually, can I say something? This is the family mire. It's the family now. This is your family. Everybody in the family messed up. Even the church auntie. Who got one of them church aunties? She leave church and start smoking weed, cussing everybody out. She got 16 different boyfriends, be coming over. Y'all know I ain't lying. But she got a holy word though. This is church auntie. This is grandma. This is you. I want you to see something. So what happens is your children's mess that they started with from you. This is why your kids drive you crazy and it's a hell. Because now they mess starts being poured into the family muck and the mire. And now the family says, I don't know what's wrong with her. What's wrong with her? Why is she out here doing this and doing all that? And she got a little fast tail. Well, it's because auntie showed her how to be fast. It's because you had 12 different boyfriends in 6 different years coming over. And she heard the screams from the other room. Listen, let's be honest. And then you said, well, why is she being fast? Because you gave them that dirty water. And then eventually they start pouring their same cup of dirtiness into the family muck and mire. And now you got family issues. You got family trauma. And now you're like, man, what's wrong with my family? Well, Jesus, help me. You've been pouring all of the filth that you've been receiving into your spirit and your body into the same pot now.
Come on.
This is why you got 5-year-old girls twerking the sexy red and getting famous. And the parents don't think nothing wrong with it. What's wrong with the mama? I don't know what's wrong with the mama, but how did the mama get to the point to where she let the baby do that? See, this is now a family problem. And oh my God. It's like a family burial up in this joint. It's like family issues, family matters. You got some problems, you got some trauma. But watch this. I'm gonna take one kid and get him a pure cup. And that one kid who got a pure cup, I love Jesus. He gets it from the Father. And that one kid starts pouring the pure cup into the dirty water. Y'all lucky I can't overflow this or I would, or we'd be in trouble.
Get the garden hose.
But do y'all see how the water gets lighter and lighter? With the more water, you see the vision. You see the vision. Can you give me some more water? Just give me four more and we'll be all right. But do you see one person loving God's word can start cleaning the family? You wonder why I'm preaching to you about loving God's word? It's because I know what it can do for your family. I watch change in people's lives all the time in transformation. And you know what they say? Man, bro, if you can do it, I can do it too.
Right. You can do it for me, you can do it for you.
How did I meet you? Tell me I'm lying. You ain't got to tell us, but how did I meet you?
I was in trouble.
What do you do now? Where you work at?
Metro Transit.
Metro Transit.
Nice.
It's been a struggle though, ain't it? It's been a struggle, ain't it? But he came to get some word. His life ain't perfect. But he came to get some word. Thank you. Come on, son. This is why when people be yelling at kids for being on stage, I never yell at them. Pour it in here, son.
That's how you do it.
You know why I never yell at them? Because if kids start to view church as a place where they get yelled at and screamed at and tormented, why would they want to go when
That's
they're
right.
older?
Why would they want to come? Just like adults.
Some of us wonder why our adult children won't go to church. It's because you made church not fun. It's because you made church a place of torment, yelling, fussing. Shut up. Be quiet. You got your church shoes dirty. And then your kids say, well, I don't want to go to church no more. You know why? Because your kid is correlating that they get slapped when they get a scuff mark on their shoes. So why would I want to go to church when I'm old enough to not have to go? I remember good stuff, but I also be quiet in the aisle. Pitch. Shh. Pastor talking. Have y'all ever heard me hush them kids since they've been in this service? You stop letting kids be kids, you're going to create little teenagers and little adults that want to have nothing to do with the church. I'm not telling you how to parent. I swear I'm not. But what I am saying to you is this. If we turn church into a place that they don't want to go,
Dark roast coffee.
Yeah,
dark roast.
That's just the enemy fighting back.
That's
uh-uh.
right.
You get baptized, you strong.
Nope, that's not it. Y'all didn't peep the first example. The cup has to overflow for it to get clean. Y'all ain't see it. Y'all ain't see it. The cup has, give me one more of these. Give me one more. Give me one more. Give me one more. The cup has to overflow for it to get clean. You can't just fill it up. It has to overflow. My cup overflows. And ain't that what David said? My cup overflows. He didn't just fill my cup up. He overflowed. Oh my God, you better give God some glory because my cup overflows with the word of God. He didn't just fill me up. He filled me up and it overflows up out of me. Paul said, Timothy, I encourage you to preach the word of God. When you preach the word of God will flow out of you. It overflows out of you. It don't just rest on the inside of you. Give God 30 seconds of some glory that he deserves because the cup will overflow. When it overflows, it overflows. Somebody say overflow.
Overflow.
Y'all ain't give God enough glory for me, but I'm gonna leave y'all alone.
Struggling, Pastor.
I get it. Listen to me, family. I know y'all getting this. I'm about to be done. Family, thank you. Yes, sir. See, we want it to overflow. We want it to overflow. Keep bringing me water then. Keep bringing me water then. Keep bringing me water then. I need more water. I need more water. We might need more hands, but we need more water. We need more water. Come on. We need more. Y'all want it to overflow? Somebody say overflow. Somebody say overflow. Overflow. Let's make this thing overflow then. Let's clean your family. Let's clean your house. Let's clean them years of curses. Let's clean them years of generational trauma. Let's clean them years. Hey, this water costs now. Wait a minute. Salvation is free. Hey, let's clean all them years of hurt. Clean all them years of pain. Clean all them years of death and destruction. Clean all them years of lust. Clean all them years of jealousy. Let's clean it up. Somebody say clean it up. 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 I need more water. Come on, son. Come on, son. Keep it coming. Give me a hose. We need more water. My God. Thank you.
Thank you, God, for your overflow. Thank you, God, for your overflow. Overflow us, Lord. We can overflow on others, Lord. That's right.
Somebody say overflow.
All right now. I think we, I don't think this being gonna carry no more water. We gonna get in trouble.
We got it. We got it. That's it.
It's clearing up. It's clearing up. You see the vision? You see the vision?
God clear.
Family, let the word of God overflow in your life. Good job, son. Give me some. Huh? No, we don't want to play with it. We don't want to get it wet. Let the word of God overflow in your life. Let the word of God overflow in your life. You saw how it purifies things. Thank you. I think we got enough. Let's do altar call. If you want to pray, even just for an overflow of the word of God. Okay, mama. Hey, y'all better get this out of here for my kids get water everywhere. If you want to pray, that's okay, little man. That's okay. You know what? Pour it, son. You ain't get to pour one. Go ahead, pour it. Go ahead. A little bit, though. Hey, no, that's it. Good job. Good job. If you allow the word of God to overflow in your life, you will see family change. You will see children change. You will see yourself change. You know why? Because you cannot pour God's word in you and it doesn't do something to you. You cannot. Can I tell y'all a story and be done? I believed in Jesus, sold out. I was preaching in the county jail. Got to prison. Y'all know this part. I got to prison. Saw somebody get stabbed and killed in Leavenworth, Kansas. I said, oh, no, Jesus, I love you, but I got to, kind of be, me a little bit, I don't think you're going to work in here. And I backtracked a little bit, not a little, a lot of it, I ain't going to lie, I backtracked a lot of it. And this lady started writing me letters. Hey, I seen your brother. Guess what she wrote me, where she seen my brother at? She seen my brother at the club. And I miss my brother, man. He said, hey, man, you better write my brother a letter. He in jail. Oh, my God. Okay, I'll write him a letter. He's still in jail. I thought he'd be out by now. No, he ain't get a year or two. He got 10 years. She said, oh, okay. She started writing me letters. And I promise you, this is a true story. Let the word of God overflow in you. I had read the Bible for almost 2 years straight, only book. I read it periodically. Stop reading it like that. Start backsliding. She started writing me about the Bible. She sent me her notes from church. Every Sunday, this lady went to church and would mail me her notes. this is what the word was about. This is what, you know, Bishop said, blah, 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 blah. Mail me her notes to every service. Now, I said, I'm going to start telling this church girl about the Bible to make her do this time with me. It's a true story. And I thought that I was going to manipulate her because I knew she liked the Bible. And some of y'all probably like, wait a minute now, Pastor. Just listen to me. But I had to read the word in her notes to give her the word back. I started getting back into the word. Y'all remember my Celly I told you about? He said, bro, God got a light on you. I heard you a great preacher. You a pastor. You a man of God. He going to get you. I said, nah, I'm not. I got stuff to do right now. I'm going to spend my 20s in jail. I'm going to party till I'm 35, and then I'm going to go back to God. That was my literal plan. I prayed to God, let me make it to 35, and I'll be back. That was an actual prayer of mine. But this lady keep writing me the word. Let's do a Bible study. These were the notes. What were your notes from church on Sunday? And I can tell you this because I know I'm not manipulating the gospel. So I don't care what people think. But I'm like, hey, baby, yeah, you know. But I'm getting in the word. My Sally praying for me. And I'm more and more word. Another brother come, more and more word. Now I slip into church. And I slip into a Bible study. Next thing I know, a dude named Pete. He comes, he's from a church out. He comes, he preaches the word. And he preaches and he's, hey man, fire word. I start feeling real convicted. See, you can't keep getting the word in you and not feeling conviction and not feeling change. Y'all think that I encourage y'all to come to church and Bible study just because I want to see the seats full. I encourage you to come because you can't get conviction and you can't keep getting transformation if you stop. You got to keep getting the word. It never stops. What's the one thing that shall never fade away?
Word.
What?
Word.
What?
God's word.
Not one jot, not one tittle. The one thing that will never fade away is the word of God. He created the worlds by speaking the word. The word became flesh and died for us. If you keep getting the word, something will happen. But if you stop getting the word, you start all over like the cup. Because you stop getting the word. And you put Sexy Red back in you. And you put Cardi B back in you. Now you got the cup back filthy again. And you got to find another place to get the word. To get Sexy Red back about you. To get Cardi B back about you. To get Dirt back about you. To get Lil Yachty back about you. You see? But I kept going back to the word, and the next thing I know, I wasn't sitting at the table with the guys, I was sitting at the table with the Christians. The next thing I know, they was coming to me saying, hey bro, you sitting at the Christian table, man, with them snitches and blah blah blah. Bro, what's up with that? You was with me. And I say, man, but I believe in this word. Wow. And LA say, who are you? I don't know you no more. Amen. And I say, LA, but you do know me. This is who I was before you met me. Wow. So, well, who is this new joy? He'll tell you, who was I when you first met me?
Yeah, you sit at the table.
But I kept going to the word. I didn't quit. I didn't give up. Even when they told me to do preaching in churches, just trying to have people give it. They had tithes and offerings in church too. You bring your commissary, he was bringing it. He's just trying to get stack up his commissary for us. So I said, I don't care. Amen. Because whatever that man is doing is between him and God, because I'm going to tell you something right now. I need a word. So even if I don't go to listen to him, I'm finna go get a word from somebody. But I'm not finna allow his behavior to keep me from getting a word from somebody. And the next thing I know, my mentor, who was a Muslim, it's a true story, who was a Muslim, said, hey man, You changing your life, huh? I said, man, this is who I was before you met me. And he said, well, do you still want to do all this stuff that we doing? And we weren't doing nothing illegal. We used to do like martial arts and stuff like that. And he said, you still want to do this? I said, yeah, I can still do that. He said, okay. He said, well, give me the, because I ain't gonna lie, you weren't supposed to have like fighting gloves and mitts in your room. You can get rolled up for that, go to the hole. He said, well, give me the stuff and I'll hold it. I said, you sure? He said, yeah, I got 5 life sentences. I said, okay. He said, man, you changing your life. I don't want you to get in trouble and have to miss going home because of something like this. So I gave it to him. And we start having conversations, Jesus, his belief, all that. He said, Jordan, I'm a Muslim now. I'll never be a Christian again. But this is what he told me. He said, the reason why I'm not a Christian no more is because I've seen the way that people manipulated the word. So he walked away from the word because of the manipulation of the word. And can I tell you the second piece? Because of anger from getting 5 life sentences. Him and his co-defendant were the first people ever the state of Minnesota tried to give the death penalty to him. But they ended up not giving it to him. They just gave him 5 life sentences instead. And he said, the way that they tried to kill me, and they had never done that before in state history, he said, I can never believe in their God. Because nobody ever gave him the true word. The true word is Jesus is for everybody. And Jesus loves everybody. And Jesus don't belong to one particular race, one particular culture, one particular creed, or one particular group of people. Jesus died for the world. And because the word died for the world, I went from trying to manipulate my wife to buying her a Bible we can share together and do Bible study. And then I went to studying all the scriptures again. And I said, baby, can you go and find my Bible I had over here that I sent to my brother's house and try to send it to me? Because I want my Bible with my original notes in it. Because I wanted the authenticity of the word back in my life. But it only happened because I stayed in the word. So can I encourage you for 10 seconds and be done? No matter what happens in your life, even with church, never abandon the word. Ever. I promise you, the word of God will see you through. The altar is open, prayer is open, salvation is here. If you don't know Jesus, to come and know him. God bless you. I love you. In Jesus' name, amen.